So I will not run, here, it's new, but just save some time because some of the questions have already been posed. And this is the outline of the current BCLC as it was presented in 2012. And it was not incorporated in the guidelines because it was kind of preferred to adhere to what was in the American. And here you see this kind of treatment stage migration that is already in place in the early stage. When you have all these associated diseases, comorbidities, you jump from resection to transplant, or from transplant to resection, or resection to ablation. And this is something that is already in the model. And when we wrote this update, before it was in seminars, and then it was in gastro this year, what we made is more emphasis in how to evaluate liver function. So when you think of the child puke, you have to remember that this was developed to evaluate the risk of surgery for variceal bleeding, mostly transection of the esophagus. And the statistics were very, let's say, soft at that time. And it became clinically appealing. And we know that child puke C, this very dismal, child puke A, some of them can be decompensated, can have ascites. So it's not really capturing all the profile that the liver patients may have. And this is why we brought this asterisk here and here and here. And note that child puke classification is not sensitive to identify those patients with advanced liver failure that should go to transplant. And this is important in the knowledge by hepatologists because we refine the evaluation according to encephalopathy that may not be present when we visit, or prior infections, prior bleedings. This is what is instrumental to refine the child puke. And I think that this kind of frames the discussion between the intermediate stage and the liver function, because if patients are in impaired liver function and cannot be transplanted, whatever we do in terms of treatment for cancer will not surpass the risk of death because of liver cirrhosis. And this is important when we evaluate the patient and decide what kind of option we should get for them. And this is why we had this asterisk here and have refined how we evaluate the liver function. All this thinking of the impact of liver function in the outcome was already there when we ran the SHARP trial. There was a claim at that time to incorporate patients in child puke B because these are more frequent and we see patients with advanced liver failure, and in that way we would recruit faster. And we said, not the case. If we bring in the compensated patients, we are going to have a competing risk of death because of the cirrhosis, and even if sorafenib is beneficial, we are going to have a confounder that may kill the trial, kill sorafenib, and have a negative trial. And clearly this was the case because we captured the benefits of in survival, and we did not have deaths related to liver failure without almost no death prior to progression. So this is something that has to be retained in the design of the trial. So we all know the benefits of sorafenib, but we're not going to invest in this. And the questions that were there at that time, this was 10 years ago, are still there. We do not have biomarkers to detect who is going to benefit the most, who is not going to benefit at all. The thinking is that all patients benefit from sorafenib, irrespective of all parameters. We cannot assess the response by biomarkers. At a point it was, if we have a delay in tumor progression, if we have also response that in sorafenib was marginal, we could improve the outcome. But it would be more powerful, and it may be that being more powerful means more toxicity and more death, and we have examples of that. The other point is that the response rate measurements are, would say, old-fashioned, and I have explained repeatedly that the reductions in size may have no surrogacy for improved outcome because there are no statistics to show that a given reduction in percentage correlates with better outcome as compared to absence of response. And indeed what happens is that what makes the difference is the delay in progression rather than the response when we are talking about systemic therapy. So I already mentioned the biological power would may come with toxicity, and we have the discussion about how to begin with full dose or lower dose and ramp up. The current recommendation is to begin with full dose and reduce the dose according to the recommendations, because it's very likely that if you suffer or are afraid of the side effects, you will never ramp up, and this is quite common. And the analysis that have been done suggesting that half dose is even better are biased, because obviously it's better to begin high dose, adjust the dose and cope with it and have a good effect of the drug, rather than to begin at full dose, have progression, early death, and then you have the patients of full dose that contaminate the survival because they do not have received the treatment for long and the tumor has progressed quite fast. The willingness to avoid the adverse events that justifies the start with lower dose is based on this wishful thinking that we do not want to impair the quality of life of our patients, and I am a very good medical doctor and I want to be nice to my patients and just do not impair them. So adverse events are unpleasant, but they may not be detrimental. So we proved with Maria Rich, who is seated here, that the development of dermatology adverse events early during follow-up is associated by an unknown mechanism with a better outcome. And we did this with a sophisticated statistical approach, doing time-dependent multivariate analysis. This means baseline, evolution, time points, all the parameters all together, big database, big outcome, and we proved that those that present adverse events have a better time to progression, so the tumor is delayed in terms of growth, and we also reported that they have a far better outcome. So doing strategies to reduce the adverse events going low dose, we may miss the benefit that is associated to the adverse events. And this is something that now has to be implemented quite well, because now we have sorafenib that is effective first line, and now we already know the results of Rego. So we have to secure what is tolerant, what is not tolerant, so that we benefit from sorafenib first, we adjust the doses, and then we get the benefit of regorafenib later on. So these are the trials. This is boring because this has been mentioned several times. All the trials were negative in first line trying to beat sorafenib. And this is something that has to be retained. The FOLFOX regime that is said to be positive in China, because a reason that I will not detail, was negative. But the situation in China is what it is, and this is why it was classified as effective and recommended by the Chinese FDA. But negative is negative and cannot be positive. And here you have the list of those that have failed in second line, and the one that I just presented has turned positive, the regorafenib in second line. And I will comment a bit again. What is the reason for such a mess? The reason is that what happens in experimental plates, cell culture, mice and rats, does not really apply directly to what is going to happen in humans. And when we begin in humans, I already mentioned the lack of correlation between significant differences in TTP and improved outcome. And if you look to the TTPs of the different trials that are written here, and the final outcome of the patients, you will see that there is no real parallel, shorter TTP, shorter survival, longer TTP, longer survival. And this is something that just puts the attention to the fact that we need to change the criteria to assess response in terms of size modification, and we need to change how we think that the TTP is informative or not. And this is one of the key questions. When we look to early trials, when I inspected the sorafenib phase 2 or the regorafenib phase 2 that we did, there was this signal, and some of these tumor progressions were stratified to get the signal detected. So why did the trials fail? One is because the drug is not effective and not safe, and this is something that deserves attention, because some efficacy signals such as response may come together with toxicity, and we have example of all these things. We know that objective response may not translate in improved survival, and we have drugs that have objective response in a higher rate, such as DPF, and they came together with no improvement. We have the absence of objective response does not mean that we do not have benefit, and we know that now from sorafenib and also from regorafenib, where the response rate is not so intense. Disease control rate also is not a surrogate, and this is what appears in the table, and time to progression also may not be an adequate thing. So in a way, the definitions and parameters we use are faulty. Finally, we need to refine the design. When we did SHARP, we used the BCLC parameters of prognosis to stratify. In the Rego, I will show later on that we even expanded the stratification factors, because we know now more things about the natural history of advanced HCC and advanced HCC in second line. And this is relevant. The saying of enriched trials as more molecular profile is wishful thinking. There is no proof that this is going to work. The trial that is run by tivantinib is based on c-MET positivity, but we will have to wait for the outcome. And it is said one size does not fit all. Sorafenib fits all, and regorafenib, as I will show, fits all. So this statement by those that are willing to enrich by molecular profile has been proven twice to not be true. So going to regorafenib, this is again a dirty oral drug. It's a multi-kinase inhibitor, has different activities. To some extent, it overlaps with some of the drugs, and among them sorafenib, but has different potencies in different things. And the key point is we do not know what is the mechanism for the benefits of sorafenib or what is the mechanism for the safety of sorafenib. So the blend of what we have in sorafenib is good, and the blend that we have now in Rego is also good. So we did this phase two trial that I mentioned, and we had the safety confirmed in patients that were tolerant to sorafenib. And then we had this hint of a potential efficacy. I have to tell you that there was a big controversy about to what extent it was worth to do the trial or not, and the pros and cons, and the risk, and the field, and so on. And finally, Bayer decided that it was worth to do the investment, and this was a happy decision. The same happened with Sharp. In Sharp, there was also lots of discussion to whether to go with the trial or not. And this is the design that I mentioned. The relevant part here in the design is the stratification by five stratification factors. This is frequently not accepted by statisticians because they complain that some slots may be kept empty. But this indeed was accepted and probably is one of the keys for the success of the trial. The other key for success was, as happened in SHARP, to select the patients that were fit, preserve liver function, and that they had not advanced cancer symptoms, performance status was preserved, all these characteristics. But the key point probably was the definition of tolerability to prior sorafenib. And these are the definition that we use there: to have received sorafenib 400 milligrams daily for at least 20 of the last 28 days of treatment. This is a definition that makes sure that the patients that come into the trial are not just interrupting sorafenib because they are lazy or the physician is not willing to invest the time to take care of them, but rather there is a willingness to adjust, treat, and so on. And it has two advantages. The patients are tolerant to sorafenib, the drug itself, and they are tolerant to the adverse events that come with the evolution of cancer and the management of whatever happens. And this is probably creates a very organized group of patients that are willing to go with the options, and a very organized group of physicians that will take care of the trial, willing to manage first sorafenib and then regorafenib. This is the profile of the patient, no surprise, as I said below, male, 60 years old. We had a 40% proportion of Asians because we had almost 40% coming from there. And the etiologies are the ones that you would expect in an international trial. And here you have the distribution of the tumor burden and the liver function. We had some protocol violations, but clearly we selected patients that had macrovascular invasion one quarter. Lots of them had extrahepatic disease, no surprise. The combination is that 80% or more of them were really having dismal outcomes. AFP, we stratified by 400, and this was a cutoff that we used because of the data we had in the biomarkers in SHARP. And lucky enough, this coincides also with the cutoff in the ramucirumab trial that is said to potentially be positive in the subgroup of patients that have AFP beyond 400. And thus we are able to test this in our population. And this is the main finding of the study that turned positive. This is the main message and the main finding of the study. And it's striking by itself. So it's positive because the overall survival was improved, and it was improved in a very significant manner from 7.8 to 10.6. And this gives you a hazard ratio of 0.62, highly significant, but I would like you to pay attention to the 95% confidence interval, because when you look to the 95% confidence does not overlap with the survival of the placebo. We did all sorts of subgroup analysis, and here we have the forest plots. They were all in the tendency for a better outcome in the regorafenib arm, whatever you look at. And here you have the response rate that I also presented. And clearly, regorafenib gets more response than placebo. Either when you look to modified RECIST or RECIST, you always have this discussion, what should be used, RECIST, modified RECIST, look to necrosis, whatever you do. The important thing is likely not to get more response or whatever you can see here with partial, because this is quite to be proven that there is an inter-observer agreement. But the point is that you have stable disease, and this is something that will keep you longer in place with your patients. So when you look to the TTP, this is what we have, a superb difference in time to progression, that in the placebo is 1.5, 1 month and a half, and this moves to 3.2 in the regorafenib arm. What does it mean? That we have a hazard ratio here of 0.44, meaning that we reduce by half the speed of progression. And this is really something that is relevant, significant, and clearly, together with the survival, is clinically meaningful. When we did the subgroup analysis and the same with the progression-free survival, we have all the subgroups shifted to the benefit for regorafenib, so this makes, again, a reinforcement of the homogeneous benefit in all the populations. The thing I said, one size fits all. And here you have the adverse events, and it's, again, no surprise. We have the adverse events that are characteristic to this family of agents: hand-foot-skin reaction, fatigue, hypertension, hypophosphatemia, and increase in these pancreatic enzymes. But if you look here, we have very few grade 3 and very few grade 4 in the regorafenib arm that can be linked to the treatment. When we look to the deaths in the regorafenib arm, we did not have liver-related deaths that could be attributed to the drug. We only observed two deaths of this kind in the placebo arm. And this was a concern because in colorectal, there had been reports of death due to, let's say, liver toxicity early during treatment. And this is why in the trial we had a very careful watch early during the treatment so that we would detect any deviation from the safety early enough. And this was one of the tasks of Bruno Daniele in the safety committee. So the conclusions are clear-cut. The survival is improved. This is clinically meaningful, highly significant. Now we have something that can be in place as the standard second-line treatment for HCC patients that have progressed on their sorafenib or are tolerant. As I said, the key point now is to secure that the patients that get sorafenib, the classification of intolerance is robust and not just because we are lazy. This is important because if they have those adjustments and so on, they will benefit first from sorafenib, and when they move to Rego, they will have the further benefit from Rego. If they are classified as intolerant, treatment withdrawn by an improper reason, we will miss two benefits, one after the other. And I think that this is the main message that has to be introduced in clinical practice. This would be the scheme that now has sorafenib and regorafenib, as I mentioned before, and this is something that will play again with the first line, second line, and this is going to be more complicated, and we have to baptize these transitions or treatment stage migrations or first line, second lines. This is going to require new drawings. Everybody talks about immune modulation, and this is going to be superb. I am always surprised. I do not trust in anything, so this is a problem I have. But during all these years, I have seen the wishful thinking that sunitinib would be better, everolimus, brivanib, ramu, all, and they are gone. They are negative. So I'm sure that immune modulation has a role, and we just published the risk of tumor activation during antiviral treatment for C virus because immune modulation is distorted. So immune system prevents the tumor to grow, and if we can enhance this, we may have success. But how to do it is right now research. And I have here just to remember that what we have is first phase one, safety, so on, dose finding, phase two signal, and finally phase three. Until we have phase three, everything is research, and the hope is the hope, but the hope is not robust evidence. And I think that this is something that needs to be said, because When we had the positive results with sorafenib, there was the combination of erlotinib with antiangiogenics, and it was said that it was better than sorafenib, and finally it disappeared from the picture. So bevacizumab with erlotinib was seen as something very hopeful, but at the very end it disappeared. And we have to see if really which patients benefit of what and have robust data, and otherwise we were going to be in a mess. So what have we done in the last years? The BCLC group began more or less in 86, in between of this dismal situation where patients were diagnosed when they had symptoms. Death was quite close. Progression was just in between. So this was when the progression reflected that we are not going to do well because patients were close to death. We advanced diagnosis. We had minor improvements in survival because of the refinement of the selection criteria and so on. We proved the different options to be effective. And finally, what we have now is a further expansion. Diagnosis can be made early. Then we have progression that can occur early during the follow-up and is far away from symptoms and far away from death. And now with regorafenib and other things that I hope will take place in the next years, we will have a further expansion of death, and we will have changed in some years the dismal situation from a very optimistic plan that is what has happened in other cancer, and liver cancer should not be different. Having said that, this is all. Question for me from the floor or for my colleagues.